Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our pre-Purim Shmooze. Looks like everybody's really in the spirit. This wonderful family here is really getting us into the spirit. We see it's Purim started right now, tonight.
Yes.
Right, all the kids here with costumes, that's what it's all about. We appreciate that very much. Kids coming with that. Give us into the Purim spirit. And again, we invite everybody to please join us this Sunday in Lakewood for our Purim celebration, which will be, it's tailored to everybody, men, women, and children, to be a wonderful, joyous, outstanding, special food, entertainment, singing, dancing, music will be a real Purim that we hope that God wants it to be. Inspiring. That's the bottom line of everything, inspiring. So just to start off with some of the laws of Purim, and then we'll get to our singing, playing rabbi soon to introduce us a little bit into the evening. As we know, we read the Megillah, a Purim at nighttime, and again in the day. And nighttime means, of course, this week, this year won't be much of a question. It's after Shabbos, so for sure we won't even be fasting. Even it won't be difficult to wait for the Megillah, but it has to be 45 minutes after sundown, at least, to be considered the night of Purim. 14th day of Adar, and the next day also, we read it usually in the morning, but the whole day is kosher to read it until sundown. And everybody's obligated to hear the Megillah, men, women, and children. Of course, children, if they're very young, they shouldn't go to shul to make too much of a rash and the tumble and too much noise, which prevents other people from hearing the Megillah. We are supposed to hear every word of the Megillah, be very careful. It's considered from the Holy Scriptures, the Megillah. It's a holy book. It's not just a history book. It's from the Kisvei HaKodesh, from the Holy Scriptures amongst the Megillah's Esther you have, Megillah's Shir HaShirim, with Shlomo HaMelech wrote the Megillah, and all the prophets, all considered Holy Scriptures. So every word there is for a purpose. No word is there unimportant. Every word and every letter was written for a purpose. It was written al-pi ruach ha-kadosh according to with prophecy. It's a very unique kind of sefer, the Megillah. So we have to hear every word, once at night, once during the day. And in honor of the reading of the Megillah and the holy holiday of Purim, we're supposed to put on our best clothes, like it's in Shabbos or Yom Tov, already the night before, as if it's a regular Shabbos and Yom Tov, to put on our special clothing in honor of the reading of the Megillah of that mitzvah and honor of the day of Purim. Of course, it's a mitzvah to hear the Megillah in the shul, if possible, with a group of people together. As we know, every mitzvah that we do as a group is a bigger honor to God, like a king who has all of his followers together showing unity towards him. When we do a mitzvah, it's a preferred to do a mitzvah together with a tzibur, with a community, with a crowd of people. So if possible, a person should try to go to the shul to hear the Megillah. But if it's impossible, a person has small children and they can't get away, so then the Megillah has to come to them. Somebody has to come to the house with a kosher Megillah. Megillah has been written a certain way. It's just like a Sefer Torah, it has been written a parchment and certain laws. It has been written a certain way. And somebody who knows how to read it has to come to the house to read it for the people who could not go to shul. That's nighttime and the daytime. Because somebody who already read the Megillah, heard the Megillah, is still able to read it for others who didn't hear it yet, even though he already fulfilled his mitzvah, but he can help somebody else fulfill their mitzvah by reading it to them in the house or wherever. The mitzvah of Megillah and Purim is such a strong mitzvah that if, God forbid, somebody is sitting Shiva, Purim negates those days of Shiva, 2 days. A person does not sit Shiva on Purim, not Purim the 14th day, and not on Shushan Purim the 15th day. Chanukah, there's no such thing. Chanukah, you have to sit Shiva, but not on Purim. Purim is such a happy day. It's like Yom Tov, like Shabbos. A person would not sit Shiva on Shabbos and Yom Tov. Same thing on Purim. We mentioned last week that there's a very big mitzvah to give presents to poor people, give charity on Purim. It's a very, very strong obligation. Every person, a man, woman, and children of age, to train them that this wonderful, great, special mitzvah to give charity on Purim to poor people. We want to make sure everybody's happy in Purim. Some people can't afford to buy the items which make people happy in Purim, whether it's shalach manas, whether it's good food to eat on Purim, whether it's costumes, whatever it might be, if they can't afford it, we want to give them charity and make them also happy. Of course, the best way is they should not know where it's coming from. They shouldn't be embarrassed, naturally. They don't want very secretly to give charity to poor people. They shouldn't feel that the people are looking down upon them. But however it's done, it's a very important mitzvah to fulfill. Now, the amount of charity must go to at least two poor people. Of course, the more the better, but at least two of them. And there has to be enough money giving them. They should be able to buy some type of meal for themselves, maybe even a meager one. If they can buy something, a sandwich with a cup of coffee, so that would be considered fulfilling the mitzvah. Of course, the more we give, the better it is. The more poor people we give to, and the more money we give to, naturally makes the mitzvah more and more. Anybody who's interested, I mentioned last week, if you don't have the opportunity yourself to give out the charity, you can give it to me if you'd like, and I make sure to give it out to different poor people on Purim itself. It has to be given out on Purim. Given on Purim, or before, but given out on Purim itself. Also, the Megillah tells us that the people of that time took upon themselves to give charity and also to send food packages to one another, not necessarily for poor people. Of course, a food package is considered a charity to a poor person also. If you send them a nice meal, that's also considered charity. But we have to give mishloach manos, that's at least to one person, two food items which are prepared to eat. You cannot send raw meat or raw fish. It has to be something that's ready to sit down to eat right away. It could be challah or bread or cake, one type. It could be meat or fish that's cooked, or a drink of soda or juice. But we want to make a good feeling between ourselves, one Jew and the other Jew, to send presents to one another. As a matter of fact, the biggest mitzvah is to send to somebody that we're not so friendly with. Most people send mashlach manos, oh, I sent to them, they're such good friends, such a good friend. Yeah, that person, I'm not so friendly with them. But really, it should be the opposite. We want to try to make stronger relationships on Purim. So we should think to ourselves, the people that we know well and we're friendly with all the time, it won't be such a difference if we send them or don't send them. But the people that we're not so friendly with, maybe we had a little bit of a argument with them, we didn't get along with them so well, and we should be looking to try to patch up the relationship. So it's a bigger mitzvah to send a person like that in order to say, oh, look at that, he sent me a nice present, I'll send the back one. and try to patch up and to reformulate relationships that were lost or were never made in the beginning. That's even the bigger mitzvah. So far we talked about the three mitzvahs of Purim. Number one, Megillah. Number two, Matanas Labyanim, presents to the poor. Number three, sending food packages to one another. And the fourth mitzvah of Purim is Sudas Purim, to eat a great feast on Purim more than any other holiday of the whole year, except for Erev Yom Kippur. The two most outstanding, important festive meals, dinners, are Purim and Erev Yom Kippur. The way to judge that is that we know that a person has a bad dream. Some people fast under certain circumstances. If they feel that something is being disclosed to them from heaven, something bad, chas v'shalom, happened in their life, so such thing as fasting. Even on Shabbos, a person would be allowed to fast. Even on Yom Tov, a person would be allowed to fast. But not on Purim. A person has a bad dream, Purim night, no matter how bad it is and how scary and how much he feels that the Shemayim and heaven, they're telling him something, you can't fast on Purim. Not Erev Yom Kippur and not Purim. That's interesting. Keep Purim, right? Purim. Keep, the word Purim is in the word keep Purim. Interesting, huh? Keep Purim. You're fasting a whole day and no merrymaking in the shul a whole day. And Purim is just the opposite. And in the word, keep Purim is the word Purim, which I don't want to go into right now. It's not a coincidence. But that's how important the festive Suda, the meal of Purim, is that everybody must make sure that on the day of Purim itself, not the night before, also we're supposed to increase the amount of happiness and joy to a certain extent, but the main mishnah v'simcha of making joy and festivity is on the day of Purim, before nightfall. I have to say, at least start before nightfall of Purim itself. And naturally, we try to make it very delicious food for Purim, and not just the basics, just to be yotze, like they say, just to perform the bare necessity of eating a meal, but to be something that we really look forward to, the whole family, the food everybody likes, and a few courses, and naturally, a little bit to drink a little wine or schnapps to get a little happier than usual, to make things really happy, joyful, and lively. Okay, so that, in short, catches up with the laws of Purim. So to get us started over here, as usual, we are so happy that we have been able to merit from God life to come to this great occasion, Purim coming up in a few days, and sort of kickoff tonight of Purim, that we're able to enjoy the great holiday. And of course, I want to discuss now the type of joy. As mentioned last week, as we grow as adults, we have to grow in our ideas of Purim. Some people, they remember Purim as kids, and they stay with that idea for the rest of their life. It's like a person who goes to first grade and learns 2 and 2 is 4, the second grade 2 and 2 is 4, the eighth grade 2 and 2 is 4, they go to college 2 and 2 is 4. We don't think very highly of a person like that. As you grow, we expect your ideas and your knowledge and your philosophies to increase and become more concentrated, more elevated as we grow in our age and our ideas and understanding of life. The holidays also have to become more meaningful and more full of elevation than we were when we were kids. So the joy of Purim for kids is one thing, but we have to have the joy of an adult of Purim, which I'd like to discuss a little bit pretty soon. So we're very happy that we've come to this great time of our life, the month of Adar, the month of happiness, and the holiday of Purim, the holiday of happiness. And therefore, we'd like to ask our wonderful banjo-toting rabbi to get us off with the Shechiyanu, thanking God that he kept us alive to come to this great day of elevation and joy in his service, to be able to serve him with joy and meaning. So Rabbi Eichel, could you please serenade us?
Yes.
Thank you.
start off with a Purim song to listen to the Rosh Hashanah Siakim, or something, you know? Something from Purim. Huh? Okay, whatever. Is asked in the Gemara, we know that every holiday we say Hallel, except for Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, but Sukkot, Shavuos, Pesach, Chanukah, we say Hallel, special prayer, praising Hashem, praising God. It's every passage almost of Hallel's talking about the praise of God for the great miracles that he did for us and every holiday. How come in Purim we don't say Hallel? That's the one holiday we do not say Hallel. And certainly, it's a day worthy of praise to Hashem, to God, for the great miracles that he did for us in Purim, saved the whole Jewish nation. So the Gemara answer is a very interesting answer, which we have number one on our glossary sheet. Kriyasa Zuhi Hilula. The reading of the Megillah is the praise to Hashem. That's the praise to God. That needs explanation. The reading of the Megillah is the praise. And this takes some, we have to put into the Megillah, according to this answer that the Talmud tells us, we have to use our mind, our intellect, and it's a service to God, reading the Megillah. Now what does that mean? It's not just a history book and the story that we're reading. The Purim of holiday of Purim is very unique, different from all other holidays. All of the holidays were Nisim, Guluyim, open miracles that people saw the hand of God without any question. Pesach, they saw the 10 plagues, open miracles, water turning to blood, splitting of the Red Sea, Shavuos, Mount Sinai, God gave the Torah, he came down on Mount Sinai with lightning and thunder. Everybody saw the hand of God, was no question. What they saw was not natural. It was supernatural. It was happening at Mount Sinai, holiday of Shavuos. Sukkos, they saw the Anei Kavod, clouds of glory that surrounded them. They had water come out from the rock, and manna, food come down from the sky. Open miracles. Chanukah, burned for 8 days instead of 1 day, miracles. On Purim, no such thing. There's no blood turning into water turning into blood. There's no splitting any Red Sea. Somebody might read the Megillah and say, well, it was a nice story. Everything just happened to be every person at the right place at the right time. I don't see any miracles in the Megillah. It's all natural happenings. Nothing special, no water coming out of a rock, and no food coming down from the heaven. It's a story that happened. And there was a Mordechai, and there was an Esther, and she became the queen, and therefore she saved the Jews. That's called Nisim Nistorim. Number two, miracles which are not obvious. And we can relate to the holiday of Purim in a way more than we can relate to any of the other holidays. Meaning that we, as Golus Jews, were in the diaspora, were exiled out of our country. We are also not in the situation the Jews were when they were in the land of Israel with the Holy Temple being built, where they saw open miracles all the time. We don't see open miracles. Everything is hidden. God's hiding behind himself, watching over us, making sure that we're surviving. So we can relate to the holiday of Purim in a way more than any other holiday, since we're Golus Jews, just like the miracle of Purim happened in the Golus. It happened out of the land of Israel. The Jews were in Persia at that time. There were very few Jews in the land of Israel. There were some, but very few. And the bulk of the Jewish people were in Golus, in the diaspora, in exile. And we have to read the Megillah and delve into it and think about it and realize that these are not natural phenomena, things that are happening, but there's a master plan, a master power making things happen every step of the way. It's not happening by itself. There's a force behind everything that's happening over there. Why it happened, when it happened, to whom it happened. And then we have to take it and apply it to our own life as a nation to look back in history of the Jews since we went into the diaspora exile and realize for almost 2,000 years now we're out of our land of Israel without the Holy Temple being built. And we're still around, even though we don't see any open miracles, but we know that God's behind it. we wouldn't be able to survive if he wouldn't be behind us, keeping us alive and keep us as a nation. Northern nation has survived so many years without a homeland. Only the Jewish people, with such a small fraction of the population of the world, with every place we went, they tried to annihilate us. Everybody knows any Jewish history, all the years that we've been, all the different countries of the world, always tried to get rid of us one way or another, and we're still here. So we have to take the Megillah while we're reading it and see the different steps of what happened. As a matter of fact, there's this holy book that's written called Yosef Lekach, that every passage, every pasuk of the Megillah, he shows that's part of the nes, part of the miracle. Not one pasuk is written there that's not in putting into the whole puzzle of the Megillah, that each piece that's put in, till we come to a beautiful ending of the, what happened. But there were a lot of pieces, a lot of things that were happening, going on. I'm sure he could have written 100 books like that, putting all the facts that happened at that time. But it was all concentrated into one Megillah, and all these psukim are telling us, if we really think about them, something that was going on that God was making happen for this thing to come out the way it did. When we read the Megillah, we're supposed to think and look, this happened. Why did that happen? God made it happen. If it wouldn't have happened that way, the miracle wouldn't have happened. He made it in such a way, things happening, the master plan, that he put the pieces into each step of the way in order for us, the Jewish people, to take the proper steps and make sure that things worked out the way they did. As we read the Megillah and realize these things and see this master plan unfolding in front of our eyes, we're supposed to thank God. Thank you, God, for being behind us and making things happen. That's what Chazal means. The Gemara says, the reading of the Megillah, that's the halal, that's the praise. Meaning, we have to look into everything that happens in the Megillah, realizing that's God's hand that's in motion and making everything happen, and think to ourselves, thank God for what you did, for everything that you put into the right place at the right time that saved the Jewish people from annihilation. That's the Hilula. That's the Halal that we have to think about. We have to be awake, reading them, not to fall asleep and not to get bored, God forbid, reading the Megillah, but try to, this is a very good way to keep ourselves awake and alive and on the ball, reading the Megillah. What can I take out? What do I see over here? That if this wouldn't have happened, the whole miracle wouldn't have happened. God was behind it. He made the right thing happen at the right time. And therefore, I have to thank God. Thank you for being with us then, over the generations, till now, in our own lifetime. We have to look at God's hashgacha pratis. He's watching over us, not only as a nation, but every individual. We have to realize everything that's happening to us is not happening by itself, but to try to trace back our whole life till now, our life, what's happening at this moment, God's behind it. Where we grew up, where we, people that we're friendly with, people we married, moved to one place, moved to another place, and trace God's hashgacha pratis, where every person to realize that things don't happen by themselves. So therefore, I wanted to take out certain parts of the Megillah to show, and of course, it would be much too much to go through in one night, but some certain parts of it to contemplate, to think, and realize. And when we read the Megillah, to think about it and see that God's hand is in every step of the way. And as we say, the wise man hears and adds on his own ideas and thoughts. Once we get started in this path of taking apart the Megillah, analyzing the Megillah in this way, see where God is showing himself, hiding himself behind what's happening, but he's making it happen. It didn't happen by itself because so many coincidences to happen in one story is, we realize that it's impossible. It's not a coincidence. So I have over here number 3. Atamoin Hamalka Vashti Lavoi. As we know, the king made a big party and he had all his friends over there and they were drinking and drinking and they're getting more shikr and more shikr. And finally he decided that he wants his beautiful wife Vashti to come, show her off to everybody. And she refused to come, and he had her executed. And that's how Esther comes into the picture. God wanted Esther to come in to ultimately to save the Jews. So he caused the death of Vashti. Now what was the story over here? It happened to be on Shabbos that this happened. It says in the beginning, it was on the seventh day. Shabbos was the time that Achashverosh called Vashti to come. But he didn't want her to come like a normal person would come. He wanted to come without any clothing on, in front of everybody. And she refused. Our rabbis tell us, God judges people, mida keneged mida, a measure for a measure. The way a person sins, that's how they're punished. This Vashti used to do what the Germans did in the concentration camps. She would cause Jewish women to disrobe and work on Shabbos. She would force them. She would desecrate the essence of a Jewish woman. Jewish woman is her modesty, to be modest, not to show herself. And she wanted to destroy that essence of a Jewish woman and to destroy the modesty and made them disrobe on Shabbos. And work on Shabbos, which is the essence of the Jewish people of Amunah. Shabbos is a cornerstone of the belief of the Jewish people that God created the world. And God watches over the world. God makes everything happen in the world. And this Vashti wanted to destroy all these fundamental pillars of the Jewish nation, of the Jewish woman, of every Jewish person of Shabbos. That she would force them to work on Shabbos. And therefore, mida keneged mida, measure for a measure, God punished her, this very wicked, wicked woman. And on Shabbos, she was told to come in the natural, and she wouldn't come. And therefore, she was executed. When we read this in the Megillah, we have to think about God was behind this. It didn't happen by itself. Mida keneged mida. We have to think on our thoughts. Thank God for getting rid of this tyrant of a woman that she's forcing the Jewish people to do things against our basic religious beliefs. And also set the stage for Esther to come into the scene. Didn't happen by itself. We have to think to ourselves, this is the hand of God. It's not just it happened to be the actual called her, happened to be on Shabbos, happened to be he told her to come in such a way. It was all a master plan of God behind it, making it happen, opening up the door for Achashverosh to do these things. And think to ourselves, we thank God for his intervention over here, for his making things happen in such a way, for the called the Makkah, Refuah before the Makkah. God prepares the healing before the sickness, it's called. Before God was preparing Esther to be in the home of Achashverosh, the palace of Achashverosh, before the whole Zayin, before the whole decree happened. He was setting up the opportunity and the circumstances for the Yeshua, for the salvation to come eventually. So we have to, as we're reading the Megillah, it's one of the things we have to think about, that what's happening over here is all God's hand. Nothing happens by itself. And think to ourselves, Hallel. The word says that Kriyasa Zuhi Hilula. Hilula, this reading is that, is the praise. To think to ourselves, thanking God in our minds. We're saying the words of the Megillah, what happened, and thanking God as we're reading it, to thank Him for doing what He did. So what happened? The king was very, very disturbed, boiling angry, like it says, burning with rage. And he called his advisors to see what to do with this terrible thing that Vashti didn't listen to him, his queen not listening to him. And they came up with a very strange, pretty silly kind of idea. And we have a number five that the Mahuman was really, Haman really was at that time, but he wasn't so great at the time, telling the king that it's not only for him that she did a terrible design for him, an embarrassment. He tells her to come, she won't listen to him. But this is going to go around the whole 127 countries of the king, of the different Medinas, of the different places, provinces of the king. It's going to get around all the women, they're going to start saying, we don't have to listen to our husband. Look at the, Malka didn't listen to her husband, so we don't have to listen to our husband, so therefore kill her. Now, this is pretty silly reasoning, because I don't think anybody in their right mind would think that Vashti did anything wrong by not listening to her husband and coming in such a way, in such a unbefitting for a queen, for somebody and sitting in the royalty, to come in such a embarrassing type of thing, to come in front of all the men of the drunken people over there. I don't think anybody in their right mind would think that she did anything wrong by that. And therefore the people start saying, well, she didn't listen to her husband. We don't have to listen to her husband. She didn't listen because she shouldn't have listened to him because he's crazy. We know he was a very, very desirous person. Person who loved partying and loved having all the different pleasures of the world. And this is a pleasure that was way out of bounds that he wanted. But God put into this person's mind to say, come up with this silly argument that if you don't kill Vashti, so all the women are going to stop honoring their husbands and just don't care what they tell them anymore. There'll be a lot of problems at Shalom Bayis. Don't be any priest in the home anymore. There'll be a lot of arguments. So, therefore, she should be executed. God was behind this whole thing. Make it happen. Doesn't make any sense. But if God wants it to happen, and they all agreed to it, that's a great idea. You're right. Very poor line of reasoning that a king with his advisors should listen to, and especially give her a death penalty for a thing like that. Like it was a very act of decency that she was doing, and execute her for that. Didn't make any sense. But God made sense in their minds, and we have to read the Megillah and think to ourselves, this is not a natural thing that's happening here. It's not water turning into blood. It's not splitting the Red Sea. But what's the difference? God's behind it, whether he makes open miracles or closed miracles or not obvious miracles. He's making it happen. He's putting it to their minds and setting the stage for what's upcoming. Getting ready, have Vashti out of the picture, and now we have to have Esther to come onto the scene. So we have to think God's behind it. And the reading is the praising, to think to Hashem, thank you for the next step that you did, for seeing to it that she's out of the way. People listen to this silly idea that he's trying to tell them. And they go forward and listen to the advice, and she is executed. Next step. The king afterwards is very sad. His Vashti, that he liked so much once upon a time, killed her in his rage. I was telling a person should never do things when they're in a rage. It just come to haunt him afterwards. And he was very depressed. So his advisors, again, this wonderful, that came up with a great idea. Imagine this idea, it's unbelievable. It's a great idea, unbelievable idea. He has to pick a new queen. Number five, he calls Minarva Vasula. So go around all the countries of the king and look for the beautiful woman to be the king's queen. And how do you do that? You get them all to come to Shushan for 12 months to get them ready with all different oils and spices and perfumes. 12 months to get them all ready, all these women. And every night, the king spends a night with somebody else. For how long? 3 years. Every night. So look at somebody, somebody. It's unbelievable. It's as blows your mind. How is it possible for a king, how is it possible for advisors to do such a stupid, idiotic, mundane, disgusting way to act? A king? God gave this advice, put it into their head. It's got such a thing. It's an embarrassment for the whole. Some people say that the reason why the Megillah Esther was not written down because of all the stupid things that happened, and they made sure not to, the historians of the Persians, they didn't want to write it down. They were embarrassed to write down what happened. So there are hints to what happened in the history, Persian history, but the whole story is not recorded totally, because it's an embarrassment to Persian history at that time. The king should act so stupidly, one step after the next. He has very poor advisors, gets very poor advice, and he does things that are outrageous. And Esther, by the way, all the women would keep, didn't want it. They all were hiding. They didn't want to become the queen. Imagine, have a chance to become a queen. Well, what a great idea. They didn't want to become a queen by him. They knew he's a lowlife and not a good for nothing what he is. And nobody wanted to be the queen, but he forced everybody to come. All his people, Pekidim. He had all his messengers going all around the 127 provinces collecting these beautiful girls, women to come to Shushan. Esther was in hiding for 4 years. She didn't show herself for 4 years, keeping away from him. She was extra special hiding. She did more than anybody else. But it didn't help. They spotted her. They detected her. And they forced her. Vatilokach Esther, Elbez Hamelach, she was taken by force. She didn't want to go in the worst way. She didn't want to even have even the slightest idea that maybe she'll be chosen as queen. At this Russia, this wicked, terrible, low-life, disgusting person, she didn't want in any way, naturally, to have any connection to him. But God had different ideas, intentions, and he saw to it that they noticed her, somebody saw her, and they said, oh, she has to come into the contest. Let's see, maybe she's the right one the king wants. So she, without any choice, was taken. All God's plan. We have to think about reading the Megillah, not just a story. See God's hand over here. That the stupid idea that they came up with, but it led to the fact that Esther was noticed, she was taken to the king's palace, and she had to be one of those in the running for a queen. When it came her time to come to him, to go to him that night, It was very upsetting to her, naturally. It was disgusting to her. It was she didn't ask for anything. The king gave an order. Whatever the girl wanted to come to, she could come with them. Whatever, all kinds of elaborate kind of clothing and all kinds of different, Medrash tells of all kinds of different chariots that came, all different things. They wanted to make an impression on the king. She didn't want to impress him at all. She wanted to not impress him. She didn't ask for anything. Just let me go in the most simple way. Only what they pushed upon her. And lo and behold, it doesn't make any sense. Here they're all coming and they're so elaborate and they're so dressed up in such a way and they're coming in such a... And she comes very simply, Esther. As a matter of fact, there's one opinion that Esther was Yakroikas. She was very ugly, I know what some say. She was Yakroikas. She was green. Her complexion was terrible. But she had chut shel chesed. She had chen. Certain chen she had. There's a difference of opinion. But she was beautiful. She's not beautiful. But whatever it is, God had this intention. He wanted her to become what she became. And it doesn't make any sense, the whole thing. But God's behind it. Doesn't have to make any sense. He makes it happen. And that's what happened. So we have to read the Megillah and think to ourselves, Hashem, you were behind this. You made it happen. We realize it. Things don't happen by themselves. We have to become stronger in our belief in God, that He runs the world. You made this happen. Thank you very much. This is the Hallel. Thanking Him. Thank you for making these things happen which are not natural. They're not blood coming out of water or splitting of the Red Sea. But what's the difference? You're making it happen. You can make water turn into blood, and you can make people come up with silly advice and do ridiculous things. You're behind it, whether it's open miracles, whether hidden miracles. You're the one behind it. You're making it happen. And we thank you very much. So maybe Rabbi Reich, maybe we can have some kind of, here we're having a happy point that Esther becomes the queen. Maybe we can have some kind of musical interlude over here to keep us going with the right kind of feeling. What are we going to sing now?
Thank you.
talking about now. We say this in our prayers, night, morning, and afternoon. Add Alanisim, and when we bench, we thank God after our meals, we add this prayer, thank Him Alanisim for the miracles and for the salvation and the great strong acts that He did for us and for the help that he did for us, our forefathers. So that's what we're talking about, these Nisim, Nistarim, hidden miracles. But what's the difference? They're miracles. God's making them happen. It's just we have to open up our eyes. Nisim Gluyim, right in front, we can't deny it. Nobody can deny it. We see in front of our eyes the water turning to blood. Over here, we have to open our eyes and think and realize that's not happening by itself. Nisim Gluyim, that's the Jews in diaspora. We don't see open miracles. We see the hidden miracles. So, she was chosen to be the queen. And what happens? Mordechai was always there. He knew something's cooking over here. He knew something's going to happen. Something great, something out of the ordinary is going to happen here. This great tzaddikus, Esther was a great tzaddikus. She was a prophetess. Esther was from the greatest women who ever lived. Esther was from the greatest women who ever lived. She was a prophetess. She was a tzaddikus. She was very special. She should fall into the hands of this lowlife. Mordechai knew there's something here more beyond what the surface. Something that's going to happen here. Something great's going to happen here. Something special is going to happen here. Can't be that just it happened to her for no reason. God is behind it. Everything that's happening, you can tell that God's behind it. Doesn't make any sense. Therefore, he was sitting there every day in the court of the king and sort of seeing Esther walk by once in a while, and they would make eye contact, whatever it is. But he's waiting for something to happen. He knew it's going to happen. He didn't know what. But he knows Esther's going to be involved and something's going to happen that's going to be more than a day-to-day happening. Something that's going to be very overwhelming, very special. So he's sitting here waiting to see what God's going to do next. While he's sitting there, so we know the two servants of the king, Bigzan and Seresh, are plotting to kill the king. Now, they spoke not in Hebrew, and not in English, and not in Yiddish. They spoke in their dialect, their mother tongue. They came from a different king was over so many different countries, different languages, and they were talking in their language. And they didn't think anybody knows what they're talking about. Mordechai, who was part of the Sanhedrin, in fact, he lived in the land of Israel before. He came into Golos, as the Megillah relates to us, that he was sent into Golos, into the diaspora from the land of Israel. He was on the Sanhedrin, on the high court. And any person in the high court has to know 70 languages. How do you like that? Every person in the high court has to say, you know why? The main reason is because the high court has to decide on major issues of the Jewish people. And major questions come up, and different people come with all kinds of quarrels between them, and they have to decide who's right, who's wrong, and you have to have witnesses that come to say testimony. He did this. He's right. He's right. The witnesses have to come to give testimony in front of the court, and the court has to decide according to the testimony of the witnesses. Now, the law is that a judge cannot decide a case according to the testimony of a witness through an interpreter. We know interpreters can make things very different from what the person talking really wants to say. They can get the wrong idea. I was over a joke, a joke that this Jewish person spoke only Yiddish, not English. They pulled him into court because they thought he stole, someone stole some chickens. So they thought he's the gadav, he's the thief. So they brought him to court, and he can only speak Yiddish. So they brought an interpreter. So the judge says, ask him if he stole the chickens. He says, du hast gegangen mit the chickens? Ich bin gegangen mit the chickens? Yes, he stole the chickens. He says in a question, ich bin gegangen, I stole the chickens? Oh yeah, he stole the chickens. You dive the chickens, you need it? He would dive the chickens. He needed the chickens. That's the interpreter told the judge everything he was saying in the question. He told him a statement. So you never know, an interpreter can change things around. So a judge cannot decide a case if he doesn't understand the language of the witness. He has to understand directly. Therefore, since they were in the high court and they had to decide all kinds of different cases, they had to understand every language, otherwise they could not decide according to the testimony of the Edom, of the witness, if they understand them. So Mordechai, being in the high court, he understood all the languages, so he realized and knew what these people are plotting against the king. They wanted to kill him. Some say they wanted to poison him, different opinions how they wanted to assassinate the king. So he heard what they said, and told Esther in the roundabout way, got to Esther, and Esther told the king about it. The king investigated, found that it's true, put them to death. And this was one of the main reasons of the Jews were saved afterwards because of this incident. So what happened? You could just read it. Well, it's a coincidence. He happened to be sitting there, and he happens to know all the languages. But we know as we read the Megillah, God's behind it. It's not happening by itself. It's part of the master plan over here. It's going to be used later on. The king wrote it down in his book of memories of chronicles of what happened when Mordechai the Jew saved him, which later on was a very important piece of the puzzle, how the Jews were saved at the end. Again, we read the Megillah, we have to think, God, you made this happen. It's not a coincidence. It's a hand of God is guiding everything that's happening and everything over here. Thank you. We have to, reading the Megillah, that's the thanks. We have to, every step of the way. Just like on Pesach, we say the 10 plagues, when we dip our fingers, dumb, thank God for bringing this plague, the Svardaya, thank God for this. And we say words of Hallel. The same way we read the Megillah, we have to realize what's happening and think to our minds, thank you God for everything that's happening. And relating to our lives again, just like God watched over us then, He watched over us through all the years, through all the countries and all the different troubles we went through. We're still around today. And everybody in their personal life, to think about, God, you're behind it. You're making everything happen. I thank you for everything that we have as a nation and as an individual. And then the king raises up Haman to be next to him, second in charge. Whatever reason he saw in him, he must have some kind of credentials, Haman. He must have been not a simple person, obviously. He had certain greatness to him, and the king saw fit to make him in charge and above all the other officers and advisors that he had. And we're told, why did he make Haman have such a high position in the court of the king? Because he wanted Haman to be known all over the countries of the king, because he wanted Kiddush Hashem to come out. He wanted, ultimately, people are going to hear what's going to happen when Haman's downfall comes and Mordechai comes in his place. It'll be a great Kiddush, sanctifying God's name, showing that the great miracle that happened to the Jewish people. If it would happen to a lower, small clerk or somebody that came to a miracle, to somebody who was not known through the kingdom, throughout the kingdom of Achashverosh, such a good kid Hashem wouldn't have come. People wouldn't have known about it very much. They wouldn't realize that such a great man, Haman, that he was second to the king, and the whole thing happened through him. And it was so known. He was known to everybody. Everybody was afraid of him. Everybody respected him. And through him came the great miracle, which was realized by all the nations of the world of the greatness of the Jewish people. So he wanted only to come through a person who's known so much. So therefore, God made behind the scenes, he made Chashverosh take this Haman and lift him up and make him in charge. And he heaped poor, he made this raffle, which month to annihilate to kill the Jewish people, it came out in the month of Adar. And he was very happy about that, Haman, because the month of Adar is the month where Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses died, just last Sunday, was the seventh day of Adar, that was the day of Moshe Rabbeinu that he left the world. So he figured it must be a very bad month for the Jewish people if Moshe Rabbeinu, the greatest of the Jewish people, the greatest man who ever lived, he died, he passed away in the month of Adar. It must be a very bad month for the Jews. So he figured that's great. His raffle that he made really worked, that it came out to be month of Adar. But he didn't realize that Moshe Rabbeinu was born also the seventh day of Adar. And tzaddikim, the day that they're born, that's the day that they pass, leave the world. That shows a big tzaddik. So just the opposite, it's a great month for the Jewish people because Moshe Rabbeinu, the day that he was born, the day that he died, that shows such a great person, everything was perfect by him. The exact amount of years he's supposed to live to the day. But behind the scenes, when we go to a raffle you have that $100 million that they're raffling off, you know, they have the whole, Powerball, and somebody wins it, it's not a happening by itself. Oh, he happened to win it, he's so lucky. Every person who wins, whatever they win, whether they win a dollar, win $1 million, $100 million, God's behind it, it doesn't have by itself. There's a reason for it, why that person in Kentucky in some place in a gas station on some kind of remote road, they bought a ticket and they won it. There's a reason for it. We don't know why, but in the future, when God will pull the curtain and will see everything in the world, why, we'll know why that person won the raffle over there and why that person won over there. But there's a reason for everything. Nothing happens by itself. And this, we have to think to ourselves, that Hashem, God made it come out in the month of Adar. That was a good month for the Jewish people. Another very interesting, I guess we really have to wrap things up already, getting late already. At the time that Haman came to the king and said, I want to get rid of this nation. They're no good. They're different from everybody else, and they have their own holidays, and they have their own laws, and you try to collect taxes for them. They say, we can't pay taxes today. Shabbos, can't pay taxes today. Come next day, no, today's Yom Tov, we can't pay taxes. They're always Shabbos and Yom Tov, and they're not good citizens, and they're not worthwhile having around. It'd be very good to get rid of them. And Chazal says that nobody can speak slander as good as Haman knows how to speak slander. He knew how to get the king. So he came with this whole thing, and they made the decree to destroy all the Jews. And the Jews went through, at that time, a lot of pain. They knew what's happening. King made a decree to kill all the Jews. So we're told by the great commentators on the Megillah, great rabbis, as we read the Megillah, we have to live along with it, not just read it as a story that happened. So far, we're living along with it, realizing God's behind it, thanking Him for what's happening, but we also have to live along with the pain that they went through at that time. Imagine how they're feeling, men, women, and children, all to be killed in one day. That's worse than the Germans. One day they kill all the Jews, one day, that was the plan. And they were full of agony, sorrow, pain. And as we read the Megillah, we have to also try to live with that, what they went through at that time, to feel how pain they went through. Poor Jewish people at that time, and that means, happy poor everybody. And that means that if they went through such pain, then God goes through such pain. When His children, His great nation, the Jewish people, are full of pain and agony and worry. So God himself is full of pain and worry and agony. Whatever that means for God, we don't know what it means exactly, but it means something. To feel that as a part of the Jewish nation, we're all one. And to go through the Megillah like we're living through the Megillah. We're doing through the problems, the sorrows, and the happiness as things are going on. We want to feel that we're part of it. Evel Godol, great mourning, fasting, crying, sad speeches. And that's what they were going through those 3 days that they made during Pesach it was. They fasted on Pesach, as a matter of fact. Even though they're not allowed to fast on the holiday, but because of the terrible decree, they're fasting and praying for God to have mercy on them, to save them. So this is something, as we're reading the Megillah, again, we have to feel, not just read it as a history book, but feel what they went through then, what the Jews went gone through all the generations, different problems and agony and sorrow. We have to, just like on Pesach, we eat the morah, right? Same thing we can compare. We eat the bitter herbs on Pesach. Why? Because we're supposed to feel the pain of the Jews in the Mitzrayim and Egypt. It's nothing new. This is something the Torah tells us on Pesach. We have to apply it to other times also to feel the bitterness of the Jewish people. We feel on Tisha B'Av, different fast days, we're supposed to feel of the difficulties the Jewish people went through at that time. On Purim, even though it's such a happy day, but these few psukim, these few moments that we're reading it, we have to try to empathize and feel along with what they were going through at that time. In order, if we feel the agony and the pain, then we're able to feel the joy afterwards of the saving. The more we're into the problem, the more we're happy when we get out of the problem. And so on, these are some of the examples of, as we're reading the Megillah, our theme tonight is, we can't look at the Megillah as we've read it so many times already, and we know the story already. That's if we're just reading it as a book, as a story. If we're reading it as we're trying to find God's hand, how he's making things happen, so then we praise him for it and thank him for it. The Megillah can't become boring like that. It can't be a thing that we know it all. What's the difference? But it's alive. It's something that we can put ourselves into the whole golus of all the history of the Jewish people for the last 2,000 years, that we've gone through all the same type of thing. All the same type of things, but not all have such a happy ending like that in Purim. But we have to put ourselves into what they went through to see God's hand and apply it to the Jewish nation and to our own personal life. And this is, I have some of the other things over here that's just this, it's but not even half the, but half the Megillah coming through. But as we go on, as we're reading it, my suggestion is we start to have our best to look at everything that we're reading and see God's hand in it and keep thanking him and thank him for that. And for now, to realize that God's hand is with us as a nation and as individuals. So this is what I'd like to give over tonight. And maybe there's some comments or questions that you'd like to, before we get really into it. And start. Do we have the mic? Oh.
You mentioned about the importance of the Megillah and how it is supposed to elevate the holiday of Purim. And yet, if the Megillah has such an importance, why is it that the name of God is totally absent? It's an obvious question, and there must be an obvious answer.
Yeah, well, that's a great question. And what we describe now is exactly the reason. God's hiding himself. He's in diaspora. When we're in Golos, God is hiding himself. He's not showing himself openly. He's behind the scenes. That's exactly why his name is not mentioned in the Megillah, because of that reason. He's behind it. Well, if we look into the great Kabbalists, show us that in different words, his name is there, if you see it the right way. And the name is there many times, but it's not open, it's all hidden. All with the same theme. The Megillah is, the word, why is it called Megillah, by the way? Megillah is in Gilui, uncovering, disclosing. The Megillah brings out the whole story. It happened over many years. If you put everything together, you see a master plan, Megillah to us. It seems we can read it in a few minutes, 45 minutes maybe, half an hour, but it covers about 12 to 15 years of time. So from the beginning of Chashverosh, the third year of his Malchus, and went into the 12th year, and so on, and afterwards, it, because of right, so on and so forth. So it's many things happened during that time, and the people can get might get the right impression that they're not connected to one another, all the happenings. And the Megillah connects everything together. As we see that God, behind the scenes, he made everything happen. But that's exactly what you're asking is the theme of what we're saying tonight. That's what all the great commentaries tell us. God's name is not mentioned in the Megillah because he is behind the scenes. He's not showing himself with open miracles. He's showing himself behind the scenes. That's why his name is not mentioned openly. Hidden, it's there. If you take a look, I'm saying that the great Kabbalists give us, show us, point out, God's name is here, God's name is there, with certain letters put together, the end of this word, the beginning of that word, and so on, but it's hidden, it's not in the open. I'm glad you brought up that point, that's a very important point.
Rabbi, two questions. One is, when the king's messengers were traveling the 127 countries, obviously they knew that Esther was Jewish.
They didn't know.
How did they not?
She didn't tell him. It says she wouldn't tell him who she was.
But, I mean, wouldn't it be obvious to them? I mean, she lived in a, you know, Jewish area and all of that. That didn't really come to play.
Well, we don't know exactly where she lived. They lived amongst, I don't know if they had a ghetto then or mixed with the... But she would not tell the king who she was the whole time.
So it was even hidden from the messengers that brought.
Yeah, that's right. So they didn't know. She kept the whole Torah secretly where she was.
Okay.
We're told different stories about that. But one of the reasons she would not tell her background because she came from King Saul, Shaul HaMelech. She was from the tribe of Benjamin. The first king of the Jewish people was Shaul HaMelech, King Saul. She did not want to tell the king that she comes from royalty. Then he really would have allowed her. She said the king usually didn't want to marry commoners. He usually only married people who came from... Vashti was from royal blood. She came from Nebuchadnezzar. She was a great-grand of Nebuchadnezzar. She was royal. The fact the king now made this whole ridiculous search for a wife was not common for a king to do that. Besides the craziness of it, but he would not marry a commoner. He'd only marry somebody from the royal family. So he went against his usual tradition of the kings then. If he would found out she's from the family of King Saul, then he really would have been.
So she
didn't want to tell him. That would be another reason why he'd want to marry her. So she kept it. That's one of the reasons she kept the secret, not to tell
him. So that made it even bigger miracle, the fact that he didn't know that she was royalty and he married her as a commoner.
See, right away, see, picking up some more, you pick up more things that God's making happen.
Interesting. Yeah. One more question, Rabbi. I know that, whenever I think of Purim, obviously all the festivities and so on, but there was also the interesting story from Nuremberg where when they were hanging the Germans, all of the Germans that were on trial. Interestingly, one of them, I think it was Stryker, that actually, his famous last words before they actually hanged them was Purim Fest 1946.
Right.
Do you have any insight on that, Rabbi, or what that was really all about? Is that just an acknowledgement of?
Well, it's really what the theme of what I'm saying tonight, that we take Purim as Golos Jews, of exiled Jews, of diaspora Jews, and we apply it to our whole history in the last 2,000 years. The Jews have gone through all the different pogroms and inquisitions and all the countries we've been in, and we've been chased and killed, and we keep coming out okay, we're still here. And that's exactly what he's saying, Purim. They try, they keep trying all the time. And it happened from then to now, but everything in between. He might have said it then, but I'm sure it was said by many of the wicked people. As a matter of fact, when Haman came to Ahasuerush, as we said, none of it's written in the Megillah, but we have a lot of information that was given down in the Medrash. Ahasuerush said to Haman, I'm afraid to start up with the Jews. Look what happened to Paro. Look what happened to Sisera. Look what happened to these people. And I don't want to start up with them. Every king starts up with them, ends up finished.
So it's almost an acknowledgement that it's a losing battle to fight right. against the
when
Jews.
Right. Muhammad and finally talked him into it. Now it's different. You see, God doesn't like them anymore. They went to Golos. And of course, it's a lot to talk about because the prophecy was after 70 years, the Jews will return to their mainland. That's Israel. They were in Golos. They destroyed the temple. First temple was destroyed, and the prophets were saying, in 70 years, you'll return and build the second temple. And they made a cheshbon that they figured out that the 70 years went by already. They made a mistake. And they thought the 70 years went by already, and God didn't take them out. As a matter of fact, in this great party, Ahasuerus put on the clothes of the Kohen Gadol that they stole from Beis HaMikdash that time. They kept it. They holy clothes, and they're waiting for the 7 years to come. 7 years came, nothing happened. He said, oh, God forgot him, but doesn't care about him. He put on the Kohen Gadol's clothes for that party. And there was when they made a mistake in how to figure out the 70 years. But they were afraid to start up with the Jews. They knew what happened, so he taught them into it now. But again, it was saved again. So what he said then was really the story of the Jews all the years. That's really what it was. As a matter of fact, there's a in the 10 sons of Haman that year, and what happened then is a remez from the Rabbi Biderman. You remember that when Rabbi Achman, the says me Haman, how that Streicher's Purim. There was a whole cheshbon there. How come to date over there?
Dates matched.
Yeah. It's centuries. Unbelievable. I forget, I think, what it was. It was one shout out to point out to me what he said then. And then when they're hanged, they send the census of Haman, there's certain letters, small letters there for whatever reason, and those letters come out to that date that he's talking about.
So nothing's a coincidence.
Oh yeah, that's even more than I heard.
Interesting. Yeah. There are no coincidences.
The only difference is, of course, maybe a different Erev Purim talk about that Purim ended up great and Second World War didn't end up great. There was also the Zayre of Hitler, Yamach Shemoy, to kill all the Jews, men, women, and children. And Haman made the same decree. Of course, Hitler came from Haman, no question about it. He was great-grandson of Haman. How come in Purim everybody was saved? And how come during the Holocaust they weren't saved? That's the question in itself. The same Xavier, the same decree. They wanted to kill all the Jews. And how come it ended up so happily then and so tragically afterwards?
Is that because he's not happy about the way things were, you know, the way we were following the Torah
You have to go into that naturally. Maybe next year we'll discuss that. What? Yeah. There's always some Kol Dovah Dovah, send them and Haggadah, Amnul Chalaseinu, every generation.
Rabbi, is there a reason that we don't light candles, Erev Yontif, Erev Purim, like we do for Erev Yontif?
Well, we're told that we should light candles. You should have the house should be fixed up and nice and taken care of like Shabbos, and candles should be lit on Purim too.
And you make the same bracha?
No, you don't make a bracha.
No bracha, just light the candles.
But you should light candles. I mean, it's a minhag. It's not a obligation, but it's a nice custom that people light candles to show that it's Yom Tov. The Sudas Purim, you light candles, and the next day for sure you light candles.
But is there a reason that you don't light candles with the bracha?
Well, The reason is because on Shabbos you can't light candles on Shabbos. So therefore you light it before Shabbos to make sure that you have candles that's light in the house. And Purim you light, light candles, so we don't on Shabbos or Yom Tov we have a special a mitzvah of Shabbos because you can't light candles on Shabbos. You light before Shabbos because you want to make sure that they're lit. But Yom Tov too, you're not allowed to do malacha. You can't light do things for not a purpose. No, but it's not the same thing. Yom Tov because the special Torah law of Yom Tov. It's not. You see, the Purim is a rabbinic law, and Yom Tov is a Torah law. So therefore, we're more strict about Yom Tov to light candles than we are in Purim. But it is a mitzvah too. It says in the Shulchan Aruch here they should light candles on Purim too.
Doesn't that just mean that the candles should be lit up?
What? It
says Yom Tov Shulchan Ayaruch Neris Dalkes. Doesn't it just mean the house should be lit?
Like no, it's supposed to show a special kind of a special thing. The candle, the house lit is every day of the week, every day and night. But you want to show that today's a special day. You light special candles, covered Yom Tov.
Rabbi, when you read the Megillah, we be able to hear that over the phone if somebody cannot make it to go to the shul?
If worse comes to worse, maybe, but you can't because over the phone, it's not the original voice of the person. It's transferred into electrical currents and then comes out on the other side with a voice again, but it's not the original voice of the person, even though all speaking is like that, but that's the natural thing. But over the phone, you're hearing a remaking of the voice. It's not the original voice. And therefore, if there's no other choice, it's better than nothing, but it's not lechatchila, it shouldn't be done if at all possible. Same thing with saying Havdalah. Some people in the hospital are sick, whatever it is, over the phone, there's no other choice to make Havdalah, but it's not the preferable way to do it because it's not the original voice of the person. If you want to hear Havdalah from somebody else, we're supposed to say Megillah by ourselves. Everybody said Megillah by themselves, but we have a Shomea Ka'onda, we have a general rule. By listening, it's like you're saying it. But if you have to listen to the voice of the person, but over the phone, it's not the original voice, it's reconstructed the voice. So therefore, it's not considered like the real voice of the person. Therefore, you should...
Thank you.
Rabbi Rechman has a question. You give him a special mic.
He always tries to catch me. But,
It would help if he turns to the mic.
It's not a good question. See, the mic's not working.
Chas Shalom, I just want to know the answer. Why is there a mitzvah to get drunk on Purim? It's certainly it's an unbefitting way for religious people, especially rabbis, to act that way.
To act that way, to act which way?
To get drunk.
To get drunk, no. Anybody that doesn't act right has no permission to get drunk and poor. Somebody who knows how to act, and they act favorably and full of simcha. What is the simcha of Purim? What is the happiness of Purim? Just a happy day, maybe the happiest day of the year. It's certainly close, way up there on top. The happiness of Purim is what was our whole theme tonight. The fact that God is so close to the Jewish people. He watches over us. He's a special nation. We're the chosen nation of Hashem. He never leaves us. He's always watching over us. That is the happiness of Purim. So we're supposed to get shikr with happiness. We're so happy that we drink. We're able to sort of take away sometimes people a little bit, hard for them to bring out their emotions. You drink a little wine, you get a little happy, so your emotions become out stronger, and people sometimes a little bit, what's the word I'm looking for? Inhibited, that's the word I'm looking for. They're inhibited. They can't bring emotions to come out. So wine takes the inhibitions away, and you're able to act with the whole simcha. But anybody who acts not properly has no right to get drunk and poor. That's not it. Look at all this form, tell us that. That's my point. Somebody once told me a very bashful, shy person, told me the most happy day of the year is Purim for him. He's so shy. So what is, because he dresses up in a suit, totally, nobody knows who he is. So totally dressed up in the costume. And he gets dances and sings. Nobody knows who he is. He's not inhibited anymore. That happens. Once he takes off that suit, he's so shy, he can't do anything. So one day a year, he says, happiest day, because he can take all inhibitions are taken away. And so some people, by drinking wine, it's like getting in that suit. It takes away the inhibitions, and you're able to be dance and to be happy and to be sing. And so that's why? Because we're so happy with the greatness of the Jewish people. But if anything besides that happens, drunkenness is not acceptable by Jewish people. But people go across that fine line sometimes, and they don't follow. And they sometimes drink when they shouldn't, and then they act silly and do things they shouldn't, and that's not what it's all about. Okay, Rabbi Achman, answer your question. he acts great when they're in Purim. He's special. If you want to see, come Purim. You'll see Rabbi Achman in action.